Hello and a very warm welcome to the Punters Lounge live on your Saturday the 24th of November. We've got a great day of racing coming your way. Pukekohe Park, our pony to look forward to. Stephen Hunt is with us. And Stephen, first of all, let's get straight into the best backed runners on the programme as we say a very good morning to you.
Good morning, Emily. A fantastic day's racing up at Counties. Unfortunately, decimated by scratchings with the rain that's been forecasted later on today and also early part this morning. But there's still nine winners to be found, and punters have come in their droves this morning on a couple of particular runners I'll mention. First to Our Pony in the race two, three-year-old sprint race. Maria Dior has been very well found, according to punters. Open $2.80, now into $2.50. Now, the key around this race, Emily, is Total Excess went up as our favourite during the week, a $2.50 shot. They've basically switched around in terms of order favouritism and price. So the decent go early on the card at Our Pony has been Maria Dior in race two, number four. And up at the premier meeting today at Pukekohe, in race number eight, the Counties Bowl, one of the features today at Counties, Bostonian, $2.10 we posted during the week on Wednesday afternoon. It's now into the red at $1.80, and that includes a $5,000 bet at the opening line of $2.10, Emily.
Well, thanks very much for that, Stephen. We'll be linking back in with you later for your thoughts around the program at Pukekohe Park and also Our Pony. Let's get you straight off to the weather and track conditions. As Stephen Hunt said, we've had a rather unfortunate circumstances there at Pukekohe Park with 5 millimetres of rain overnight. That was at sort of that 7 a.m. mark this morning. Since then, I had a chat with Bryce Milden, and they've had 7.5 millimetres of rain sort of just before that 10:15 mark. So they are just assessing the track to work out what they're going to do rating-wise. And when we do have that information, we will obviously fire it through to you so you can change your selections. But I'm picking that you're going to be looking for those horses that are going to handle the slower track conditions this afternoon at Pukekohe Park. Rather unfortunate, really, with it being their sort of premier race meeting of the year, low of 13, high of 22 with Pukekohe Park for this afternoon. Our other race meeting on the card is, of course, Our Pony, and they haven't quite had such bad weather conditions. In fact, they've had a relatively calm night. They've got a nice fine day for the eight races coming your way on the meeting code of four, and the weather has been good to them overnight, and it has left for some very favourable conditions. They've got mostly cloudy with rain at times. Fingers crossed that stays away, or at least stays pretty light. Track condition a dead four, great racing surface, and the running rail is out the 3 metres. So that's the weather and track for Pukekohe Park and Our Pony, and I will endeavour to keep you updated on track conditions at Pukekohe Park throughout this morning's preview. Tony Pike has a number of nice runners on the card, of course, at Pukekohe Park, and we're going to catch up with him after this.
Running on late, Urban Angel as well, is still battling on Clairo Lake. Sacred Star, Urban Angel's going out the last shot of it on the outside, not going to get there though. Sacred Star won it. Coming after them, Levon Finn, and then back in black, more than sacred. She's kicking in now, 100 metres to go. Gets away by 2 lengths from Storming the Tower, Hydrogen and Levon Finn. But more than sacred, oh, touch too good for them. But oh, have a look at Waterford go. The money well and truly on the lolly today. From last to first, no wonder they kept putting it on. And it continued to tumble into number 7, Waterford, into $2 and $1.10 from a $7 quote earlier this week. They just kept jumping out of trees to get on. She was well back, she was last on the inside turning for home, but you saw Mark Duplessis was able to get it to the outside. It's been a great day for the trainers, birthday boy Tony Pike and Mark Donoghue. I think that's their third for the day, and she has absolutely bolted in.
Looking back at a pretty good day for Tony Pike. And Tony, I'm sure the punters at home are wondering if he can do the same today. What do you reckon?
Yeah, obviously it was a great day back then, and those horses also, you know, all went on to better things as well. So look, it'd be nice to think we could. Obviously a little bit damper conditions today, unfortunately, but hopefully we're in for a nice day.
Let's start with Terra Sancta in the County's Cup. Now, this horse raced over 1,600 metres last time at Ellerslie. Just love the way that it hit the line. How did you assess that last outing?
Yeah, really pleased with her, Emily. Obviously, she'd come back from a successful Brisbane campaign. Second up at the mile at Ellerslie. And look, she was a fair way off them turning in, but she's closed the race off really well. And then Mongolian Marshall, you know, she's running reasonably close at the end. So she's got a strip a lot for the third up. And I think step back up to 2,100 metres is really going to suit.
She's only third up today. Do you think that she's improved from that last outing?
Yeah, definitely. Obviously, third up, she should be starting to get nearer peak. She will improve at her next start again. But she's peaking at the right time of the year, and hopefully we're in for a nice season with her through into the Cups races.
Obviously, punters will remember her running that really solid sixth in the Queensland Oaks. That was over the 2,200 metres. So people can be pretty confident about her over this trip, can't they?
Yeah, look, she's by Piero out of a Galileo mare, and you know, she's spread to get over ground, and look, Jimmy didn't have a lot of luck that day in the Queensland Oaks, and she still ran really credibly behind some nice fillies. So she looks like she should be up to this class, gets in on the minimum, and looks to field with plenty of depth. It's probably one of the better Candy Cups we've had for a while, so it'll be a very interesting race.
You spoke about the track conditions. How are they going to affect her chances? We saw her racing in Queensland during that winter period on heavier tracks, so I'd be assuming that you'd feel pretty comfortable.
Yeah, I think on what she showed us in Brisbane on the softer track conditions, she should get through it better than most. But I think she will be a better mare on top of the ground. But based off her Brisbane campaign, she shouldn't have any problems with the track conditions today as long as they don't get too heavy.
The other contender that you've got in one of the feature races on the program is the County's Bowl, and it is, of course, Bostonian. I absolutely love this little horse. He's just such a professional, isn't he? And he's shown that time and time again.
Yeah, he is. Probably the only two times he got beaten, he had a lot of bad luck, once at Tirapa and almost ended up through the running rail in the Guineas at Christchurch. So, yeah, he's very consistent, very honest racehorse, and did a sprout in Queensland as well. So he's trialled up nicely going into today's race, and you'd expect him to be a strong winning chance in that fresh up today.
When we saw him fresh up in the Sunshine Coast, he hadn't actually had a trial. You've elected to trial him this time. How does he compare in those two campaigns?
Yeah, I think he was a pretty fit horse when he went to Queensland. Everyone knows we had a couple of hiccups along the way before he did have his first start. So he had been in work a fair while in Queensland, and he'd had a couple of pretty solid gallops leading into this race. So he'll strip as fit as he did fresh up in Queensland, and I'm expecting him to probably not have a lot of improvement left in him. I think we've got him pretty much bang on, because we're going to go 5 weeks into the railway after today's run.
You've elected to start him off over the 1,100 metres. Is that what you feel is his optimum distance? Obviously, we saw him in Queensland racing over a little bit further later on.
Yeah, obviously won fresh up at 1,200 metres. Michael Carley rode him all the way through his campaign in Brisbane. Said he got the job done well at the mile in the Guineas, but thought he was probably stretched to get the 1,600 metres. So I think this preparation will just keep him probably to 1,200 and 1,400 metres. And I think there is optimum trips on what he showed us in Queensland.
You've had the one scratching today with Treasure coming out. Out of your other contenders, Made of Steel, Sacred Day, how did you assess their chances in the fourth and the sixth?
Yeah, Made of Steel, she's been a lovely old mare. For us, she was actually sent down south to go to Sakinto, but ended up moving back to Cambridge Stud. So she ran a few times down there, and she's fresh up today. But she trialled nicely enough that she's in foal and she's in the twilight of her career. Sacred Day is a really promising young horse. Coming through, he's drawn the wide gate, but his natural style's to get back anyway. Look, if the track holds together, I think he's a strong each-way chance. He's very talented, but if it does deteriorate through the day, then he could possibly even come out.
Okay, that's good information, Tony. Thanks very much for that. Great to catch up with you, and best of luck on the card today.
Thanks, Emily.
So Tony Pike's thoughts on his contenders this afternoon, a pretty handy book of gallopers going around at Pukekohe Park. Stephen Hunt is back with us now. And Stephen, I'm sure that hearing Tony Pike on the phone on a County's Cup day brings back some pretty bad memories for you.
does indeed, Emily. Back 2013, those three horses we saw on footage, the likes of Sacred Star, More Than Sacred and Waterford, to really finish us off here in Petonian HQ. A lot of multis finishing on her in the Counties Bowl. From memory, I think she opened around about that $4.85 price and she closed on at $2. So, yep, it was probably early in my days, early doors in terms of being a bookie in Petone. But what I will say is it has made me appreciate those more profitable days going forward. So, yeah, it was one of those days we tend to try and forget here in Petone. And I can assure you, later that evening, we had a few stiff drinks just to calm the nerves.
Thanks for that, Stephen. Just getting back to you with regards to the Jockey Challenge and specials on the program, what have you got for us?
Well, first we'll start off with the J Challenge, Hanoi Farm J Challenge up at Pukekohe. Option 210, Emily, Leith Innes, who has a really good book of rides, probably doesn't have the numbers, six rides in total. His best rides later in the day, round 5 to midnight, Sister Beale. He has Demonetisation earlier in the day, we'll touch on that horse later in the show, but at $2.60 he's been very popular in the first 2 hours of trading. Now Sam Collett has the 9 rides v 6 rides Leith Innes, so she has the more rides throughout the day, having one ride in each race, but probably not as the quality as Leith does. Probably her best ride as a profile horse goes is Eye Grain in the Cup around Sam Collett at $5. So if you want to shop outside Leith, it's a pretty competitive market, but already we've accepted a $1,500 bet on Leith Innes to take out today's J Challenge.
Thanks, Stephen. Back with you just a little bit later on. We must move on, and it is to our pony for us here on the Punters Lounge Live. We'll be speaking to a man who's got the shortest priced favourite on the programme.
Charmont in front, Savaria along the inside of Stormina, so is Platinum Witness out deeper. Savaria with the best rails run you've ever seen. What a ride it was. Tinsley, Hayden Tinsley wins the Yates on Savaria. Photos for second.
You knew she'd run the 2400 half.
Yeah, she's a damn good filly this side. From day one I said to Dez, like, she's something special, and I think she's proven it today. She's one out of the box, and I think she'll go on to bigger and better things.
Zambesi Warrior in the right down the outside. Jack Star and Savaria. Savaria, Jack Star, perfect start diving through. Savaria, Jack Star, Savaria won the cup.
And that man, of course, that we are talking about is Royden Burgesson, and he's on the phone to have a chat with us about his contenders at our Pooney. Speaking of one of them, it is Beefeater in the Bulls Country Cup. And Royden, we'll say a very good morning to you.
Good morning to you too, Emily.
Beefeater's been doing a fantastic job, got those placings on the board, just hasn't quite got the win, but has been meeting some pretty tough company. Do you think today's the day that perhaps he can get that victory?
Yeah, we're hoping, and we're always hoping. He's run into a couple of smart horses this time up, but he's probably just been, you know, getting fitter and stronger, and he's really improved on his last couple of runs. So, you know, it's back on his home track today where he seems to race his best, and he's got a good jockey on. And it's not an overly strong field, but there's a couple of smart horses in there. He's had a few battles with Slimline and a few others in the field, but chance that aren't to be hard to beat, the one down the bottom of it. But a big chance as well.
How are you going to be hoping that he's ridden today? What are you going to be your instructions to Lisa Allpress?
She'll probably go forward from the draw. Whether he leads or sits outside the lead, I'll just leave it up to her. But he should get a nice run.
There's a little bit of rain maybe scheduled to be around there at our Pooney. Is that going to affect him at all, or you think you're pretty comfortable? You've obviously pretty close to the track, so you're going to know how the day's going to unfold.
To be fair, it doesn't look like any rain coming here at the moment, but you never know. Well, Palmerston North, because they've got such a good wind here, it can blow anything in the way here. So, yeah, I don't think a little bit of rain wouldn't bother him anyway. I think he's all right on a dead track, but if anything worse, he struggles a little bit. He's a big, striding fella.
Also on the programme, you've got Just Fabulous pretty early on in race 2. Just hasn't done anything wrong. I mean, this horse is still a maiden, has met King Louis. What are you expecting as a performance today from Just Fabulous?
Look, she's trained on really well. She's a very nice looking filly. Quite strong. The other day she didn't have the best of runs and she was pretty tough. She got beaten by Lisa Ladders. Maiden, which is Sentimental Miss, which is quite a nice filly, and I think the track just tripped her up a wee bit. But today, like, she's got a reasonable draw. I know she's still a maiden and there's a couple of winners, three or four winners in there, but I think she'll give them a shake up.
And what about the drop back to the 1300 metres? Was that intentional or just that you'd sort of found a nice race for her here?
Oh, look, I mean, she was going to go 1400 and had Timothy stay, but they had a twilight meeting and we wouldn't have got home till about midnight. So the nominations are small for this, just a 3-year-old race here. We have twice as much money as them. Instead of spending $600 or $700 on a float, then was this winner on her home track. And just kept it a bit fresh this week, and she's really well.
You've got one other runner on the program. If you had to pick out a best bet for us, what would it be?
Look, that horse and the maiden, he'll go a good race. He's always promised a lot. Yeah. He'd be a good place bet, but probably Beefeater. Look, everyone's tipped him on the radio and all over the place this morning, so I just hope I'm right.
All right, well, thank you so much for that, Royden. Great to get your insights on the morning of the races, and best of luck today.
Thanks very much, Emily. Have a good day.
So Royden Burgesson there just having a chat about Beefeater in the Bulls Country Cup. Just fabulous, and has one other runner on the program as well. We're going to get you to a break here on the Punters Lounge Live. We'll be back with more action on the back of that. We're going to push it hard. Welcome back with us on the Punters Lounge Live. We do have an update with regards to Pukekohe Park. Of course, we've seen a further 7.5 millimetres of rain this morning, added to 5 millimetres that we had overnight. That has affected the track conditions, and it has now been reassessed as a slow 7. So just something to bear in mind when you are doing your selections for today's meeting. Let's head across the Tasman now. We've got Mark Ulmus on the phone. Mark, we can say a very good morning to you.
Indeed, Emily, and good morning to you and all of the trackside viewers and audience. It's great to be with you.
Obviously, you've got a pretty good grasp on that form coming in from Western Australia, and we are in the pinnacle of their racing calendar. Just have a little chat to you about the feature, the Railway Stakes. What do you make of the field, and what do you perhaps suggest is a good way to play into the race?
Yeah, look, Emily, it's not the strongest of railways that has been assembled. History says that you need to be carrying under 55 kilos in this race. So, look, it might rule out the likes of Material Man, tab number one, then number two, Great Shot, and Man Book carrying 55 as well. The rest of 54 or less. We've got the likes of Galaxy Star, which is the dominant favourite. It's been well backed over here in Australia. Of course, William Pike, who many of your punters in New Zealand know all too well. He rides the favourite Galaxy Star. And, well, she won the Asian Bow quite impressively. Quite odd. She's a 6-year-old mare just having a 13th start. Look, I'm not sure what she beat in that Asian Bow. Action's a Perth Cup horse. He was running on really well. He comes into this race also. Also in the Asian Bow, we had Disposition, who was sound. We also had the likes of Wrinkley, who led them up and is the likely leader on paper here. So, look, as dominant as Galaxy Star was, I just think the price is too short. The numbers she's been putting on the boards in terms of time have been very good. But I think that she, well, might struggle, especially with a wall of horses on turning. William Pike will need to weave his magic. The other horse to take a look at is Gadding, and the other form line is the Lastia Stakes. Now, this is a weight for age form line, over 1,400 metres. Cully went around in this race going back a couple of years ago. Look, he wasn't disgraced. He probably wasn't suited sitting outside the lead on that day. But Gadding this year, he was dominant. He was at about 40-1 as well. Coming out of the Lastia, we had the likes of Great Shot, as well as Man Booker. So the top-class form lines come out of the Lastia Stakes. Even we had Perfect Jewel in there, as well as Star Exhibit. So, look, that's probably the key form line for mine. The other key form line leading into this is from Melbourne, from the carnival there on the first day at Flemington. Peaceful, Peaceful State comes out of the Cantala. Of course, the other Eastern States Raiders and the likes of Iconoclast. It wasn't a bad run. Got into a bit of a jostling duel to Jai McNeil with Peaceful State leading up the straight. I don't think that suited and might have just gotten a bit too far back. Iconoclast in here today can sit three wide in the running line and get a nice card into the race. In this race, like most big high-pressure races, you just want a horse that's travelling comfortably. I think Iconoclasm will be rock hard fit, and he'll be that horse travelling really, really comfortably. Mr. Seawolf was well back in that field as well, as we saw. So, look, those are the three key form lines, Emily, leading into this race. I think we can find a bit of value, though.
Great. Thanks for that, Mark. And what about $100? What are we going to do with it with regards to the railway?
Yeah, look, I'm going with number 12, Iconoclasm. He's my tip to win. My numbers, I should have said, are 12, 1, 8 and 11. Like I said, Iconoclasm, I've got him at three wide following Man Booker, who I think will be facing Breeze three wide. And I think 35 each way on him, that'll be the main play. And also worth having something on number 8, Akinastar. Came desperately close in a Kingston Town Classic last year. He's only won 4 from 14, but he's a very good horse. He's another one I can see in the three-wide line travelling very comfortably. A material man, the top weight. As I mentioned, history probably suggests that he can't win, but I'm not willing to dismiss Justin Warwick. He's not a big horse material man, but he can carry weight. He's done it in the past. He was set for a Melbourne campaign, and now he's set for his first up attack on the railway stake. Get the nice draw, should be around 1-1, and I can see him hitting the line very, very strongly. So I'll be having 35 each way on number 8, on number 12, Iconoclasm, and $15 on both Material Man and Akinastar, just to ensure ourselves, I guess you could say, Emily. It's shaping up to be a really great feature. High pressure, the likes of Wrinkley and Great Shot will make the speed, and Great Shot looking to become the first back-to-back winner of the railway since Tudor Mac back in 1967. Shaping up to be a really good nine race card from Ascot this afternoon in Australia, evening in New Zealand.
Thank you so much for your insight, Mark. It's been really good for our punters here in New Zealand. And as you said, a very competitive race. Best of luck with your picks for today.
And to all the punters out there as well, thank you very much for having me and good luck.
So that was Mark Ulmus there, who of course did a exchange here in New Zealand. You might have seen him on your screens just recently. Let's get you straight off to Ballarat. You've got the Ballarat Cup meeting, and here's a look at the weather and track conditions. A low of 7, a high of 16, cloudy with a chance of showers, southwesterlies. The track condition is soft. The running rail is out 3 metres from the 600 to the winning post, and the remainder is true. You've got 10 races scheduled for that Ballarat meeting, of course, with the Ballarat Cup being one of the features. There's a number of horses engaged in the Ballarat Cup, and plenty with actually some Kiwi interest. So certainly worth having a little look at for punters at home. To talk all things with regards to the Ballarat Cup, we've got Ben Ascari on the phone. And Ben, we'll say a very good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, Emily. Thank you very much for having me on again.
Ballarat Cup is obviously the feature coming in from Victoria this afternoon. What do you make of the field this year?
It's as strong a Ballarat Cup field as I can remember. It's an outstanding race. Darren Weir, Victoria's leading trainer, obviously trains at Ballarat, and I think he's desperate to win the race because he'd only won it once, and that was back in 2004. So he's gang-tackled the race with a number of runners. He's got another Coldy, Tradesman, Kawaya, Andrea Montegna's there. He's also got Master Zephyr and the favourite, the second emergency, who gets a run in Lucky for All. So Weir has a really strong hand, but the chances don't end there. There's another, there's plenty of class in the race. Life Less Ordinary, who's flying, Lord Fandango back in class. Mask of Time, Lover Lover. So a really good addition to the Ballarat Cup this year.
I know outside of the Ballarat Cup, you've got a number of bets for us. Can you just talk us through those and how you're going to play the day?
Yeah, well, just in the feature, if I was betting there, I think the favourite, Lucky for All, and Life Less Ordinary were the two I'd be playing. But best bet on the program, I think it comes up nice and early in race number 2, and I Am Someone, a horse that got a long way back at Moonee Valley first up from a spell. He was heavily backed there at Moonee Valley over the 9.55. I think he found it a little short from a wide draw. They rode him quietly. He got a long way back and just had no luck at all at a crucial stage. So I'd be very forgiving of that performance for Rome. Someone, I think, stepping up to 1,100 metres second up from Australia is ideal. He won second up really dominantly in soft conditions, last preparation, beating a pretty handy horse in Be Tempted, winning his maiden. He then progressed to Flemington and ended up running second to Nature Strip at 1,100 metres. So he's a pretty promising horse. He can settle much closer to the speed here. I Am Someone, and I think he looks one of probably the best bet on the program. Other horses I'm interested in at Ballarat today, I think later on the day, race number, we're going with a horse in Romanesque, who. There's been a couple of scratchings out of the race. He was one I was interested in at better odds earlier on in the week and around that $9 mark. And two of his key chances have come out. So you won't get that sort of a price anymore. But I think his chances are enhanced with two of his main dangers scratched. The step up to 2,300 is a real key for him. You look at his form around this distance, last preparation. He ended up running third, I think, behind Yogi and Gallic Chieftain in a Warrnambool Cup. That's much stronger form than what he tackles today. So I think Romanesque is backable in the third. Now, in the fifth race, there's a horse on the up here in Winning Partner. Now, he's only coming off a maiden win first up, but he ran some of the faster closing sectionals on the entire program, Bendigo Cup Day. We know his form last preparation when he was still a colt was pretty good. It ties in through some of these handy three-year-olds through a horse like Zatori. He's been gelded this prep. I think he's come back even better. And stepping up to 1,400 second up from a spell is a real plus for Winning Partner. And wanted a bit of value in the sixth race on the program. I think Would Have Thought So is over the odds. He's a horse who's a bit hit and miss, as evidenced by the big win first up, beating a couple of subsequent winners, and then a disappointing run second up. But he's one from one at Ballarat. He's got his best form at 1,600. It's pretty good. Last prep, he ran second to Iconoclasm at Flemington. So at around 15, I think you're going to get $14, $15 on an each-way basis. I think he's over the odds in this play. Each way, Would Have Thought So. So best of the day, race two, I Am Someone. I could back Romanesque in race three, Winning Partner. I could back to win in race five. And I think Would Have Thought So, a bit of value in the sixth race.
Thanks, Ben. Great to get your picks for the Ballarat meeting. We'll note them down and have a little watch this afternoon. Thanks for your time.
Thanks for having me.
So that was Ben Ascari there, just having a chat about the Ballarat meeting coming your way this afternoon. Let's get you off to Rose Hill now, where we've got Brad Davidson's selections. $100 strategy, race 7, $15 each way on the number 3. You've got $5 to win on the number 8, Most Exalted. Race 8, Strome, $15 each way. Number 8, Organza, $20 to win in race 9. And then the quaddy selections there as well for you. That's Brad Davidson's $100 strategy for Rose Hill this afternoon. Have a little look at those picks, note them down. And probably quite unusually, really, you've got WA and Victoria with that Premier Racing. Rose Hill maybe just taking a little bit of a back seat for the week. Up next, we are going to get you off to a little look at Pukekohe Park, where, of course, we've got a wonderful day of racing coming your way very shortly. You're going to find out. You can't hold me down. You see, I'm the king. Cause I got only us and I don't share well. You are.
Under, I can hardly see. Should we wait for everyone to leave? Not sure where this is gonna lead. Tell me, please. Why do I fall down?
Pukekohe Park is our premier meeting this afternoon in New Zealand. You've got the County's Bowl, you've got the County's Cup, you've also got a listed race for the two-year-olds as well as the Thoroughbred Breeders' Stakes. It's a fantastic day of racing coming up, Brendan. Just unfortunately a little bit marred by the weather, but no doubt we're going to push on through. Track conditions have been updated as a slow 7 with 5 millimetres of rain overnight and then a further 7.5 millimetres of rain this morning. So slow 7 track conditions are now what we're facing at Pukekohe. Some significant scratchings throughout the day. Just keep an eye on those. I know love affair comes out of the fillies race, but plenty to look at with regards to a big day of racing. As I said, listed race, Group 2, Group 3, also the County's Bowl as well. Let's get along to the Pukekohe track and have a little chat with Matthew Williamson to find out his thoughts on a rain-affected surface.
Matthew, already this morning we've had a downgrade in track conditions. Can you just give us the update, please?
Okay, so we've gone to a slow 7 soon after arriving on course this morning. The track was described as a dead 5 at the time. Prior to scratchings this morning, there's 5 mils up until about 7 o'clock or shortly before then. So more rain fell after that, and another 8 mils, so we've gone to a slow 7.
Okay, yeah, just tell us about rainfall in recent days. What's the cumulative reading we've got?
Not too bad. So there was a bit of rain earlier in the week, but nothing significant. The tracks remained in the dead range right through the week, and unfortunately this morning's turned into a little bit of a weather bomb, and we've had a lot of rain in a short period of time.
Okay, yeah. So the track with the downgrade, has that led to any further scratchings?
No, we've had a late scratching due to veterinary advice of in race 6 of Stephen Marsh's Laurent, but no late scratchings as yet. But we have had a couple of inquiries.
Okay, you've been monitoring this track all week, and you've been out there. What's your thoughts on how it is?
It presents really well. It's really disappointing to get the rain we have. It's probably as good a condition of Sandilyn since the refurbished. It's been refurbished. Certainly the grass cover is a lot better. It's really good.
Okay, can we get you to play weather forecast? Is there any more rain coming?
Depends what weather forecast you look at as to what weather we're going to get. Hopefully it'll stay like this with the odd shower. Nothing too significant, so we'll just see what happens.
Okay, with a stipendary steward viewpoint, is there anything significant that our punters should know for the meeting?
Just maybe in the stakes races. I mean, in race 5 in the Breeders' Stakes, Rockaboy Baby just held up running the turn at Auckland on the 6th of November and didn't obtain clear running until near the 200 metres. When running 9th, but only 3 lengths away behind Mongolian Marshall, we go to the County's Cup and Kerry Lason, disappointing for a run when attempting a marginal run near the 300 metres, again at Auckland on the 6th. When running 3rd, beaten a length, Ban Rock, and in the bowl, Mighty Me, unable to obtain clear running in the final straight on the same day, the 6th of November at Auckland. Did run 10th, 5 lengths away, but never got a go at them. And Princess Kuru in the same race, again on the 6th of November, crowded going into the bend near the 1,000 metres, then held up entering the final straight, continued to be held up and raced in restricted room near the 100 when running a second half a length behind Basu Basu.
Okay, brilliant. Thanks for giving us the update, Matthew, and let's hope we've got a clean day of racing.
We will.
Well, a relatively positive assessment there with regards to the track conditions. As good as it can be under the circumstances is what we're dealing with. Stephen Hunt is back with us. And Stephen, I understand you've got a couple of doubles for us that you perhaps wanted to update us on.
Yeah, morning once again, Emily. What we've done, we've opened a couple double markets, the City of Auckland Cup on the back of a County's Cup as well. So we've got the County's Cup, City of Auckland Cup double here, option 1975. And Mongolian Marshall, who is our pronounced favourite in the County's Cup later on this afternoon, travelling around about a $3.40 quote. $15 to take out the double, which we're only talking about six weeks away to the City of Auckland Cup. And a lot of these horses will be running there with the prize money up for grabs. 5 to Midnight, who loves Ellerslie. I think he's run the City of Auckland Cup the last 2 years at least at $35 to take out the double. You've got a couple of lightweights here that will be interesting to see how they progress against some of these hardened stayers, the likes of iGrain at $43, Tara Sackner at $51 to do the double. Hello It's Me, who has a bit of a profile as an upside, performed well at weight for age, back to handicap conditions, 101. So, yeah, what we've done, we've included and nominated every horse that's in the County's Cup today and those horses that are also nominated in futures for the City of Auckland Cup, Emily.
Thanks for that, Stephen. That was a great insight into the doubles, of course, County's Cup. Let's get straight into the Pukekohe preview, race 1 on the programme. That'll be due off at around 12:10. It is the Mount Shop 2400-metre event. And we can have a little look at the market for you with Black Magic Woman, the favourite, 5:50-2:05. Black Magic Woman surely will be assisted by that slower track in the first on the programme. So you've got 5:50, 2:05, Stephen, around Black Magic Woman. The track conditions, they've got to be a plus with Eilish McCall with the claim.
Absolutely, Emily. Look, it's down to 50 kilograms, Black Magic Woman. She would have been a massive chance regardless with the claim or not. Number 9 in the book at $5.50. It is a very compressed market, saying that. There's 4 or 5 live chances, according to punters. But probably the best lead I can give is number 3, Solomon, and the best back runner in what I say is a competitive race in the first 48 hours of trading. Solomon, who through April to September was really in a purple patch of form. 3 wins on the bounce, and prior to that was a couple of seconds. So a horse that was going through the grade, struck a good track last start, but back on a slow/heavy track, Solomon has been a decent go during the week. $6, you see its price here in that second line of betting. Shares that with Roger That, who's come in 1 full point from 7 to 6. So all the action is around Solomon. Black Magic Woman we've already touched on. Roger That's been well supported this morning. Rough Cut's been a notable drifter, Emily, $6.50 out to $7.50. A little bit of speaking for old Black Lace at $51. If this race was to jump right now, it's a losing result.
Thanks, Stephen. Let's get straight into the speed map for that first on the program. As you can see, pretty even event with regards to the 2400 metres. You've got the favourite, Black Magic Woman, with the obviously just keep an eye on those track conditions, slow 7 rather than the dead 5 that it does say at the top of the page. We say good morning to Brendan Popwell for the first time on course at Pukekohe for us this afternoon. Brendan, great day ahead.
Yeah, thank you for that, Emily. Yeah, it's an interesting race, isn't it, to start off the program here out of counties. Race number 1 over the distance of 2,400 metres, and I suppose how much the difference in the track conditions here as well throughout the whole day, in fact, which will be playing a key part, which will follow throughout the day on the slow 7. Joining us is Aidan Roddy to go through the preview. And yeah, Aidan, how much is that going to change your selections through the day with maybe what you've done yesterday with how this track is possibly going to play now?
Well, a lot of it was all about the forecast, wasn't it? And the forecast was saying that we were going to get significant enough rain. And people were suggesting we're down to a heavy. I didn't think that would be the case, although maybe it does open up. And with a bit more rain, it might happen. Down to a slow 7. I think that's probably where I'd expected it to be, in that sort of 6-7 range when I was doing selection. So it hasn't really changed too much for me. We know how well this Pukekohe track's been playing in recent times, and we heard earlier on, it has been presented in pretty good order, so not too much.
All right, let's go through a couple of leading chances in this first race of the day over the distance of 2,400 metres, and I think it's a chance to be able to get a line on some horses that were bouncing out of Ellerslie. And this is one race here where Rough Cut was able to finish into second position. We know that Rough Cut can handle some off-track conditions as well. You've also got the likes of Black Magic Woman, who was in this particular race also when finishing into fourth position, and a host of other races in behind. How do you line up this form around Rough Cut, who certainly has put the form together in his last 3 starts?
Yeah, one of the most improved sort of staying horses going at the moment. Looks to be in great nick. I was really taken by the run of Black Magic Woman, though. It seems to be a horse who's just in the right sort of zone. With the claim here, I think that's a really big help, especially with the rain-affected track. So comes down into a weight that really should make it a winnable one here. So in the end, that's the way that where I've gone. Black Magic Woman, I thought, was probably the pick of that race.
Yeah, okay. And then you've got the likes of Prince Jabeel as well, who could be a bit of a hope. But yeah, Black Magic Woman with the weight relief, with the cut and the track conditions as well, really brings the horse right into consideration. I went with the 2 over the 9 and played the 11 and the 10 as options as well. Leading into the first, Emily.
Thanks, Brendan. Let's move on to the second on the program, the Franklin Long Roofing 1600 metre event. Stephen, as we get to you, Demonetisation, the favourite, being a little bit costly to follow. What are our punters doing here in the second?
Going again, Emily, around Demonetisation, punters. Punters have been burned in the last 2 occasions this horse has gone round, in particular the Mutter Mutter Cup and also at HQ, not so much first up on its home track, 3 starts back. $2.20 trading currently off a peak of $3.50. Now, there's some key deductions throughout the day, which I'll alarm punters throughout the preview. The first one here is the 10% deduction this morning on Our King Sway, who came out 8 o'clock first thing this morning. So any bets prior to that get a 10% deduction around this particular market on option 202. Now, back to the favourite in betting, Demonetisation. $2.50 was as high as we got this morning. We included a $17,000 bet at $2.50, now remaining as price at $2.20, and leads a lot of multis in terms of individual horses throughout the 9 race program at counties. Gundown 4.40 off a short price of $4.20. Monrecur, interesting to hear Aidan and BP's thoughts around this individual. Not sure about track conditions if they do deteriorate to that slow eight bracket, but Monrecur was well supported during the week at a $5 price. And outside that, it's pretty friendless, so they're just targeting one runner here in overall betting demonetisation.
Thanks, Stephen. That's a great insight into the second on the card. Here is the speed map on screen. Aidan, as we get to you, demonetisation is a really interesting horse. What have you made of its most recent outings?
I think you've got to be forgiving it to some degree, Emily, because that really did turn into a sprint home last time out. And just speaking to Nigel Tyler earlier in the week as well, he was thinking that the track was just a little bit firmer than the demonetisation likes it. Brendan, we know the high class of this horse, and he's got to be a big contender here, doesn't he?
Oh, I think he does. I think you've got to give him another chance. And I think today is a great chance to give him another go because he's back on his home track and he gets some dig in the track conditions. This will really bring him on. Of course, we saw the horse win an Auckland Guineas in testing conditions last season. He was our leading three-year-old up to that point, of course, was demonetisation. He was the Derby favourite. I thought his first up run here was terrific, the way that he's run into fourth position. I know following that he's run second at Matamata in a cup where he was caught three wide. I want to give the horse another chance. I think he's a pretty good bet here, actually, Aidan, today with the way the track conditions are.
Yeah,
now.
I do too. Sassanos Hero is pretty good in that race. And one thing Stephen Hunt just saying about Monrecur, just a little bit of a concern now with the track deteriorating.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, that. I think that's a good point around Monrecur. The horse has been in solid form this preparation, but maybe just starting to push into a slow bracket is a concern. Betting-wise, I think it's all around the seven demonetisation.
Yeah, me too. I agree. I think we're in agreement here, Emily, all about demonetisation the second.
Thanks for that, boys. Let's get on to the third, and it is our first feature on the programme, a listed event for the two-year-olds over 1,100 metres. Stephen Bavella was very, very good last time, and although Probabil didn't win, I suppose that form relatively franked with the second placing.
Race day form, very important, in particular this time of the year. Pre-Christmas around the juveniles. Bavella did the job for punters at HQ when resuming. There's a lot of hype around this individual. $1.80. Now, that's been its price throughout the week. Pretty happy at 1.89 that the rain's coming. I believe if it was a dead-slash-good track, Bavella would have started no higher than 1.8, but there's an opportunity that price could drift on the potential of these juveniles probably never seen or never galloped on a rain-affected track as yet. There's been specking for She's a Lady at $4, and also a little bit of specking on the local number 6, 1,000 Kisses Deep at $13. You see it's travelling at $6 on the tote, but well shopped at double figure odds. But overall, best bat runner has been Bavella at 1.8.
Here's a little look at Bavella's first win, and boys, it was a pretty impressive debut, wasn't it?
Yeah, she was terrific this day, and not a bad effort as well from She's a Lady, who had travelled three wide into the race and looked pretty good. But I think the winner comes out of this race, doesn't it?
I think it does. And does it give a chance to the horse with a better gait in She's a Lady? Because I must say, She's a Lady was just as good as the winner with what she's done in the run here at Ellerslie. I do love the way that Bavella, though, has been able to be planted on speed and then surge away. I thought it was a terrific win from a horse who's going to go on with the job. Great chance to be able to test it at listed company. I was thinking it was between the three and the four. Maybe if the three started to get ridiculous, very short in the market, then maybe we start thinking about backing the four, but I was three over the four. I'm sort of around the race day experience, actually, as the sort of four key numbers in the race, with maybe a show-off who showed enough when beating a horse who was really touted to win that race in Probabil at Tadapa when last time.
Yeah, she was good. He was really good as well. Maybe a show-off, but my numbers are exactly the same as Brendan's, so 3, 4, 1, 6. I think we're the same here as well, Emily.
Thanks, Aidan. Let's get back to Stephen Hunt for the fourth. It is the Fast Track Insurance 1400-metre event. We're back to Rating 82 Company, and Aligns With Me is the favourite. But, Stephen, we've got a much more open affair here than perhaps we saw in the third.
Yeah, $4.50 the field, headed by Aligns With Me, who ran a top rating last start, running 33 or sub-33 for a last 600. It's just whether she can back up that performance. That's probably the big question mark, how heavy you want to go on. Aligns With Me at $4.50. Outside her, very competitive race. Podraig Yorkshire Dales have been well supported with the rain that's fallen in the last 24 hours, both five each of two. Not sure what to do with Swiss Watch. I think she's a little bit vulnerable on these track conditions. Happy to lay her at $6 currently in early trading. A little bit of specking around Nisa and the Kipling Girl at $12 and $8. But outside that, it's a pretty competitive race. And again, deductions will apply in this particular market with Camino Rocosa and On the Rocks coming out this morning, a 25% deduction.
Thanks, Stephen. Let's have a look at the speed map. And Aidan, as we get to you, it is a very open event here. Is there perhaps a little bit of an opportunity to make some money with regards to the fourth?
Potentially, and the map might be the guide as well, because I thought this was one of the toughest races of the day, but Swiss Watch was very good in leading throughout it. Hastings a couple of starts back, and then just got involved in that speed duel last time out. Here's a really interesting form line, though, Brendan, with the lines with me. This is back last in a race that was really one off the front, a one-win horse in a listed race, and was the quickest last 600 of the race. Massive alliance with me.
Exceptional. Like, this was a huge run from alliance with me. Really thrown in the deep end, and I found out that the horse can swim. I mean, this is a very good run to finish into third position. I mean, you think of the horse that's going past here in Santa Monica, for instance, who was so good in the Swainess.
That's you who goes around in our county's bowl.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's terrific form around horses that he's blowing past there. So if it's anywhere near that form, this is his race, isn't it? You've got an informed jockey aboard in Lindsay Satherley, of course, who won the Group 2 last week and was on song at Tarapa a couple of weeks ago with three winners as well. I don't mind Yorkshire Dales, and I certainly like it now with the track conditions getting to the point where it is now, where we're in that slow bracket. This horse ran a terrific race at Hawke's Bay behind Dark Princess. Now, Dark Princess has come out and won a Thompson. Second in that race was Mongolian Marshall as well. You've got placing form around horses like Fawn. I just feel as though it's a really good form reference. There's a little gap in between runs for this afternoon. I'm not too bothered by that. I think he comes here in a nice state, and I'm prepared to have something on him today, Yorkshire Dales.
Yeah, I found it was the trickiest of the day, and I've gone with Swiss Watch just based really around the map, but respect around what Alliance with Me did last time. Bringing stakes form into a rating 82, it should be good enough to see it competitive, Emily, although it really was only a rating 62 horse coming up into that grade.
Thanks, Aidan. Let's get you along to the fifth on the programme, the Dunstan Feeds Auckland Thoroughbred Breeders Stakes. It is over the 1,400 metres, a weight for age for the fillies and mares. And Stephen, we've got a competitive event here, Volpe Veloce 261, 2310, 210. What does the market tell us about the feature for the fillies and mares?
Strong lead on the one here, Emily, around Volpe Veloce. She was a safe bet during the week. The fact that she can handle a good dead slow track. She won a Railway Group 1 on a slow track at $2.60 off a peak of $3.30. Now, there has been a 13% deduction this morning on the back of that scratching of Love Affair, but she holds 50% of total turnover, Volpe Veloce, so that $2.60 might even shorten throughout the afternoon. Sleeping Beauty, rock solid at $3.80, and the third best bet runner is Yearn, even though it sits in the fourth line of betting.
Thanks, Stephen. And we get back to Aidan and Brendan Popwell on course at Pukekohe Park. Great to see these fillies and mares taking their place in the feature on the card. And there does seem to be those top three in the market. How did you assess the fifth?
It's a tricky one, but obviously that's a really a good push coming from Stephen Hunter around Volpe Veloce, that she is holding that much in this market and has been that well back. She handled wet tracks earlier in her career, and she's a Group 1 winner.
Yep, that's right, and she won a Group 1 on a wet track too, didn't she, when it was what rated a slow 8 in the Railway. I thought this was a nice return to the races from her in this race as well, from Volpe Veloce and the Swainess. Look, there were a number of horses that were able to, you know, peel off good closing sectionals in the race, and look, certainly she was one of them who was not far off Volk's Lightning. As you consider, first and second were up on speed in this particular race, and she was good to the line, finishing into fourth position. I just feel as though with where she sits in the race, with the track conditions now, she's going to be awfully hard to beat. I've marked her as my best bet today. I just thought she'd be a big improver out of that coming into this race. Big respect around Nicolette, because the horse has come back in great fettle, the Group 1 place getter from last season twice. Of course, placed last weekend in the Tauranga Stakes. Sleeping Beauty is the horse that brings the rock solid form and is able to get through these conditions. We've seen her, I must say, who won at Tauranga, sort of just proved that maybe she's just not a wet tracker. That was a dead four track at Tauranga when she won there, and she did beat a very good field, and she's a horse who's going to be put in the race.
Yeah, exactly. The one thing for her, she is going up to weight for age. It is different to what she's been doing in handicaps, where we are seeing, you know, set weights and penalties, Group 1 winner. But for me, it's Nicoletta. You know, she's going to be the horse who's on speed. I thought she's been really good in the last couple. So I'm keen on Nicoletta here, Emily. I thought her win, when taken on two starts back, was strong, and then that last start second had a lot of merit as well. So Nicoletta with me, Brendan with Volpe Veloce, and it sounds like the market is too.
Thanks, Aid. And let's get you to the sixth, the Lone Star Pukekohe over the 1,400 metres at rating 65 level. Stephen, favourite is the four, although is there any specking for anything else in the sixth?
Yeah, plenty of specking. This is a real up-and-coming race, even though it's only for rating 65 gallopers. Acutus back from Hong Kong, brained a field last start. $4.50, the question mark around the Son of Sepoy, whether it will handle the track conditions. Sepoy, the progeny, tend to handle the off-track, so you can punt with slight confidence there around the four. A little bit of specking around Sister Beale, $8 peak this morning, now trading at $7. Also Musical Blues, being by Rip Van Winkle, should appreciate the rain-affected going. Some real strong confidence around that particular stable. Number 15 in the book, $8 off a peak of $12 yesterday afternoon. Also, I see Red back to rating 65, down two grades. I think last time it ran in rating 65, it won in November last year. So there's four or five there specking. I haven't even mentioned the likes of Lee Sabalier, who's in the second line of betting at $6.50. The interesting runner I should touch on is number two, Sacred Day, which we've drifted notably 6.20 out to eight. I'm personally surprised at starting, and maybe it will be a late scratching if the track does downgrade between now and then.
Thanks, Stephen. Here's a look at the speed map for the sixth. Aidan, very impressive maiden victory for our favourite. So how did you assess that win? Can it go on with the job to the rating 65?
Oh, exactly. It was so impressive. And that's the thing about it. Acutus looks really good. Interesting to see Sacred Day in here, isn't it? They had been a little bit wary about a wet track and a wide draw, but we know this horse has got immense class. So I think he's got to be a factor in the race as well. It's an even open big race, and outside those there's any number of chances as well. I thought Sister Beale has some sort of hope, but here's Acutus. It's in those orange colours of the Vances, and there it is, getting back and running in the hands this day of Jonathan Riddell. He's just copped a suspension at the moment, so won't be riding today. Opie Bosson picks up the rides. It's interesting, Opie Bosson had six rides carded today, is down to two after scratchings, only this and Maygrove in the cup. But Acutus very, very good in the closing stages, and it's the horse to beat for mine. I've got it on top of the two, Sacred Day, throwing in the 10, Sister Beale, and 12, La Sablier as well. So numbers 4, 2, 10 and 12 for mine. Brendan Popple just away from the broadcast at the moment. We'll just get his numbers up for you as well and take you through those. And they are on top. Who'd you go for, BP? 12, he's gone with Sister Beale. Now La Sablier on top of Sister Beale, 4, Acutus and 15, Musical Blues. 12, 10, 4 and 15. We'll get Brendan in for the next race, Emily.
Thanks, Aidan. Lucky Brendan put La Sablier on top. It's also my nice horse to follow as well. Let's get you off to a break, then we'll be back into the rest of the preview. TAB Track Side 1, the Punters Lounge Live. Welcome back into the Punters Lounge Live. We are midway through a preview of Pukekohe Park, and the seventh is the Counties Cup over the 2,100 metres. Mongolian Marshall is the favourite at 3.40 and 4.90. Matt Cameron to do the riding. Stephen, this is one of the features on the card over the staying distance. We've got a lot of very good stayers here. What are you making of the seventh?
It's a cracking betting race, Emily, headed by Mongolian Marshall at $3.40. Was as short as $3.20 when betting commenced on Wednesday. The key is the top four or five in the market will appreciate the slow track, so there's no dramas around there. Now, iGrain was very well supported yesterday. Got as short as $6.50 in that second line of betting off a peak of $9.50. Tara Sackner's been well supported, 8-7, carrying the 53 on her back. 5 to midnight, 7.50, got out to 8. Back into $7.50 on good support this morning. The best bet run in the last 2 to 3 hours since we opened betting this morning at around about 8 a.m. has been Mega Blast, the local, back from Aussie, $7.50. Biggest liability has been on the two, Mega Blast, including a $2,000 bet at $7.50. And I just see what we've seen in the last two or three outings with Mongolian Marshall. The betting will come later on this afternoon, so we're pretty happy to keep that price at $3.40.
Thanks, Stephen. Aidan, here's your favourite Mongolian Marshall winning last time. Surely up and distance here again today can only suit.
He just seems to be an emerging talent, and we know the reputation that the Baker Forsman team have held him in for, you know, so long. I thought Terasankta was terrific coming from off the speed, but there's a 2 kilogram swing in Mongolian Marshall's favour. They both raced in Australia sort of earlier in this year, going on to the Derby in Sydney for Mongolian Marshall. He went okay in that, and obviously a sixth placing in the Queensland Oaks for the filly. But you know, they're a couple of high class horses, and add a bit of quality to this year's Counties Cup.
They do, don't they? And I think we've got the chance to be able to see some emerging talent through this race, and with some horses at the top of the handicap that have been there and done that, the likes of, you know, a Five to Midnight, who has competed through all the summer cups, you know, was good enough to win the Fielding Cup recently. Yeah. Of course, you've got Maygrove, who won this race last year after winning the Fielding Cup last year. So you've got those sort of horses in the race, and then you've got the Eye Grains as well, who will really be suited to maybe the track conditions the way they are, and love the way that horse has got home. Even Peso. Look, Peso is still an underrated horse, isn't he? Because of what he did last time out. He won a Jacobri Classic, but he's a horse who's going to be race-hardened by the training of Paul Nelson. He's a horse who can take a position. And He's Cavalier is another horse who can take a spot, who's been a big improver throughout the winter as well. So, yeah, I like the depth of this year's Counties Cup.
Just a quick word before we get back. Mega Blast, what did you make of him? Because it's just the backstory's fantastic, isn't it?
Well, isn't it? I mean, it's great to have him in the race. I mean, and if you go through his form, well, I mean, he must be close, wouldn't he? I mean, look, his Queen Elizabeth run, he's not that far off them. But the run in the naturalism as well. I mean, you consider that he ran a great fifth in that race. Sir Charles Road ran fourth in that race and has come out and run seventh in the Melbourne Cup. He'll love the conditions here. He'll revel in these conditions. He just needed something a little bit off just to be able to get his toes into the ground. I think it's a great coup to be able to get him back here in NZ, and they've thrown him into the Counties Cup. He's a player for sure in the race.
I'm really looking forward to talking to Nigel Tiley sometime during the day and just getting his view on him. He said, Emily, that he would trot and canter Mega Blast yesterday morning and this morning, and he'd know how he'd go just by seeing his demeanour. I'll be interested to get that reaction from Nigel.
Well, I'm wondering if it's stable confidence, as Stephen Hunt said, if you missed it earlier on, that he had been very well backed, the best backed of that race when they opened this morning. So watch around Mega Blast in the Counties Cup. Let's turn the page. Counties Bowl, race 8, meeting code of 2. Bostonian is the favourite, Vinnie Colgan to ride. And looks like it's really just about this horse, Stephen.
Absolutely, Emily. Number 3, Bostonian. He just profiles as a great betting proposition today. The 4-year-old Bostonian, he's had 9 starts, 6 wins, 5 of them on slower worse for 4 wins. Open at $2.10, that included a $5,000 bet we took yesterday from a customer. He's now in the red at $1.80. He's had 3 on the bounce going into this race. He's a $7 chance in early all-in betting for the Railway on the 1st of January. Now, if he was to put this field away, he would short him from that $7 quote, I've got no doubt. He currently holds 90% of the turnover in this particular race. The only other run I do want to quickly mention, Emily, is number 9, Popstar Princess, who has nibbled a couple of points, 14 to 12 this morning. But outside that, it's one-way traffic on number 3, Bostonian.
Thanks, Stephen. Here's a look at the speed map, Aidan. Bostonian, we spoke to Tony Pike this morning. He said he had him tuned up for this fresh assignment, which has got to be a positive.
Yeah, exactly. Obviously, in this speed map, Emily, we'll see him going back. Did Tony give us an indication on where Bostonian would be in running?
Or not that I know of, nope. That's probably my line of questioning, Aidan. I probably should have asked him. We needed you here.
Well, it's interesting. I had him going back. Jason Tarn yesterday on the first call had him going forward, had him probably sitting sort of somewhere off Rich Billy Marsh, but it's interesting. Stephen's saying $5,000 has gone on the horse. He's unbeaten in 3 starts fresh. He was unbeaten in 3 starts in Queensland, twice in Stakes Company, the Daybreak Lover and the Sunshine Coast Guinea. Yeah. So he's high class.
He
$5,000. Jason Tarn's headed off to Japan. Do you reckon he might have put a bit on before he left? Or we know that the Pike Stable can bet, don't they?
Oh, stop it. Jay Tarn putting $5,000 on a horse. Please. Gee, I can tell you what, I think he will take a reasonable spot, though. I think he will be just off them. He is a high quality horse. I mean, and the other thing too is he won his Group 3 and his listed wins on heavy track conditions. Yeah. So he gets a slow track condition here today to be able to kick things off. Look, it doesn't just mean that he is a wet tracker, but he's a horse who's going to be suited to what he gets here today first up.
Where does he sit for you?
In the run?
Yeah.
I think he can. I think if he gets a spot, maybe fourth or fifth. I reckon that'd be ideal for him. That's where I sort of have pictured him in the running. Where you're getting him further back, are you?
I had him a little bit further back, but it'll be interesting. I reckon they'll assess things as the day goes, and they'll know where the best part of the track is by then, and whether it's advantageous being there or making a run wider from back in the field. I've got him on top, but I thought Santa Monica was some value in this.
Yeah.
I thought on the run at Rotorua in that sway nest, when making very good ground in weight for age conditions, now goes back to a handicap into 53. Mm. I thought she was a definite chance. She was meeting, I know Vox Lightning's come out, but she was meeting that horse 7 kilograms better. So, yeah, I think we agree that Bostonian's a horse to beat, Emily, but I've got a bit of respect around Santa Monica here.
Great insight as we move on to the ninth on the programme. And unfortunately, this race has been a little bit decimated by scratching, Stephen. The Ripper, now the favourite. We've had some crucial horses coming out, though, in the ninth.
Yeah, look, 19 accepted, only the 10 going around, 9 scratchings, including the auspicious type and Rhinestone Cowboy. So there's a 50% deduction, any bets prior to this morning, Emily. And it's remained the Ripper, $4.20 chance. We'll love the mile. Comes out of a very strong race at Trentham with 5 sub-winners since that event. So $4.20, pretty confident we'll start favourite from the ladder stable. Number 2 has been well supported, Pacquiao, on the back of rain-affected going. It ticks that box. 17's on opening now, short of $7 with deductions in play there, take note. Tri-Fan, who has that wet track form around it, $10 off a peak of $12 this morning, so well supported number 14. And outside that, it's just been an even spread of money without a strong lead, but confident the Ripper will start a $4.20 loose favourite in what is an open race to finish off the programme.
Thanks, Stephen. Let's get back to the boys, and we can bring up that speed map for you for the last on the card. As I said to Stephen, Aidan, a number of scratchings in this has changed it, but favouritism does stick at the top of the page with our favourite in the Ripper.
Yeah, you wouldn't have expected this horse to be here had Lisa Ladder not decided that this was the better place where he was placed in the race. So I think he's got to be a chance. His form from CD has been really strong, and he looks like a really up-and-coming and improving horse into this.
Yeah, look, I find the race overall a little bit awkward.
It's a tricky one, yeah.
Yeah, a little bit awkward. I'm going to go to the bottom of the book, actually, Aidan. I'm going to go to the Manhattan Flame as my top selection in the race. This horse was quite unlucky last time to the races. Grant Cooksey takes the ride. It's a horse who will appreciate conditions here and even racing here out of Pukekohe as well. Look, you go back and assess that run. The horse was back last and they tried to take an inside run and just never really got any decent gaps, I thought, up the straight. So I was happy to have something on Manhattan Flame, sort of hovering around $13. And the one just above it as well in 2:30, runner number 18. Now, this horse is another runner who won't mind a little dig in the ground as well. Can operate well here at this venue as well. So when we get to our strategy, Aidan, I'm going to have something on the two at the bottom each way, 18 and 19.
Yeah, I've got it in for fourth as well. I've got the Ripper on top. Also, I was really interested in here was Red Sky at Night. Thought the last start run was just massive. And at 13s yesterday, haven't actually had a chance to reassess this race after the scratchings because there's been a few of them, Emily. But, this is an interesting way to finish. You know, for quaddy players, I think you might need to be going wide in the last leg.
Thanks, Aidan. Here's a little look at Brendan Popwell's $100 strategy. Not sure if Brendan wants to talk about it, but best bet, Volpe Veloce, then I'm blind. He is there. Yeah, much better.
Well,
let's hear from the man
Veloce
himself.
Today is my best bet in the Breeders. So on to Yorkshire Dales at a value bet. Look, it was value at $13 yesterday. It's probably getting around sort of $5 or $6 now with key scratchings out of the race, but thought the horse can be a big chance here today out of that Dark Princess form. Yorkshire Dales is an each-way bet in race number 4. Volpe Veloce to win in race 5. Igrain in the Cup in race 7, going 10 each way on that runner, and then we'll play those two runners at the bottom of the book in race number 9, 18 and 19, 10 each way. One bet, Barney, for you?
Yeah, for me, I am. My best of the day is demonetization, so I'm happy to plonk the 100 on. So 100 on demonetization to win is my each way play. We'll get the glitches and
no each
pop
way.
We'll sort
of... No one each way. It's win, mate.
Yeah, it's all on the win. It's all on the win. Yeah. We're going to get Brendan Popple's glitches sorted out, Emily, and he's going to be on comms when we come back, and he'll be able to lead us from a big dab racing here at Pukekohe.
Thanks, Aidan. Can't wait. Looking forward to kicking off that feature racing from Pukekohe Park. We're going to get to a break on the Punters Lounge Live. When we come back, we'll do the same again, this time for our podium. Dadford track and fine conditions at Awapuni. There is some rain potentially coming throughout the day, but for now there has been no rain, so we do get a perfect racing surface for our Awapuni meeting. Accompanying Pukekohe on this Saturday afternoon, Bevan Sweeney is on course at Awapuni for us, and Bevan will say a very good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, Emily. Welcome into Awapuni, where we are under clouded skies, but not threatening rain at that present moment. I know there was a little bit in the forecast, but at the present moment, I don't think there's any in the near future, at least. Eight races on our program, very much supporting the Northern meeting, but a couple of nice competitive betting fields later on in the afternoon. So looking forward to the action after what was a wonderful last night at Pukekura.
Thanks, Bevan. Certainly keeping you busy with regards to the racing over the weekend. Let's get straight into the preview, however, with the first on the card, and it is over the 2100 metres. Commanding Prince, the favourite, fours and $1.50. Commanding Prince to be ridden by Madan Singh and Stephen. An open event to start the day over the staying trip.
You'd think that, Emily, but number four is a well-backed commodity here, and Commanding Prince resumed over a trip short of its best and ran a nice second behind the stablemate, gets over 2,100 metres. That's given the green light to punters, holds three times more money than the second best back runner, which happens to be leading role in that third line of betting. A little bit of speaking around Finn, Adam Mader, 11-13 respectively, but Commanding Prince clearly the best back runner in the first over the 2-1 journey.
Thanks, Stephen. On to the speed map we go, and Commanding Prince to be sort of planted on speed. Bevan, is that how you assessed it?
Well, when he's been staying and staying well, I think we remember back to a performance at Trentham where he led up and just kept on kicking. He's at his very, very best. Now, my one sort of niggle about him is that he generally does perform very nicely fresh up and not quite so well second up, but he does have the Fraser or Rep polish, which is something you can stand by. So without a lot of confidence, I am going to go with him and expect him to probably push on to the Wellington Cup Carnival and find a race there where he'll be very, very competitive, if not winning. He may win also today. He's on top. Look, leading role. We're probably seeing the leading role we've expected over a long period of time of late. I think these track conditions are getting right to that level where he'll find it as firm as he wants. So just a watch on him. If he gets to the outside, I think that is the key to him and let down. He does have a very powerful finish. He's in for second. Jian Gua, with the visor blinkers going on, I think this horse might push forward as well and be sitting on the outside of Commanding Prince and maybe set the tempo. It was much improved a last start when running second and behind the very smart Glory Days, who's come out and won. Blinkers go on there. And outside of that, look, Finn was eye-catching. I know every time he pops back into 65 grade, he generally pops up and wins and then just flounders a fraction in the 75 grade. But he did enough for me last time and behind a pretty smart sort of horse in Red Cloud to be given a little bit of respect. So 4, 7, 2 and 5 in the first on the afternoon.
Thanks, Bevan. Let's get you along to the second. It is over the 1,300 metres for the three-year-olds. We can have a little look at the market. Maria Dior, 250-112, does start as our favourite, but Stephen, it's competitive between the four and the one at the top end.
Yeah, a little bit of a switcheroo here in this particular race. Only the half does going over the 1,300 metres, Emily. Total Express went up favourite during the week at $2.50 proposition, eased out to $2.80 where Maria Dior, $2.80 on opening, is now the $2.50 favourite. Total Access, probably more on spec that we open favourite rather than ratings. Maria Dior probably has that advantage that she's performed on the last two or three occasions in the time she's run. So, yeah, look, they accumulate a lot of the turnover. The interesting runner I should mention is Lincoln Fury, 8 out to 12. Just wanted to keep that safe to start off tracking and trading, but now to $12 to jump out winner, quite friendless in betting.
Thanks, Stephen. Off to Bevan we go. Total Access, Bevan here, seen in the trial. And what did you make of this effort?
Yeah, well, I think this horse is coming up nicely enough. It was a very good one as a two-year-old. Obviously, they thought, well, it's a horse that's going to mature. We'll give it one at two, put it aside. And I'm not sure what went early on in the trials back in August. Probably those heavy track conditions played against. But post that, the two trials at Tiamutu and Cambridge have both been very strong. Opie Bosson aboard on this occasion, and he really hasn't asked much of this particular horse. So I think it is a major player in the race. I was either way, both of these. This is Maria Dior. Now, prior to this at Waipukarau, she'd led up. They put the blinkers on for the first time, and she just led them a merry dance. She beat home, got the call that day, who's come out and won post that performance, and another smart horse calling us home of Bill Thurlow's. Really hit the line nicely on this occasion. I think she'll take advantage of that inside gate with the 52.5 kilos and Murumi pin aboard. So I had 1-4-4-1. I wasn't sure which way to go. I think they're a nice Quinella on the program. Just Feeblish ran into a pretty smart sort of horse and Sentimental Miss, who's going to head to Black Type at her next performance, and was brave prior to that behind the very smart King Louis. I thought also the 5 Got the Cause, a horse that deserved that last start win. Slightly stronger race, but it was all about a Quinella for me. 1-4-4-1, race number 2, Em.
Thanks, Bevan. Race 3 is the 1400 metre over the rating 72 level. You've got Victor Vegas at 330-130. Tote and fixed markets are separate here, Stephen. And again, we're seeing another race where it's competitive at the top end.
Look, this market's flipped upside down with the scratching of the Ripper, who we all know is going to be contesting the last at Pukekohe on their premier meeting. It's now remained Victor Vegas, top line of betting at $3.30. New stable, Peter Locke now trains as Galloper. It's had 2 trials going to this race. I've seen enough money on this individual to say that it's well forward for this particular race. Victor Vegas at 3.3. In front of Ruby Love at $3.50. Rock solid there. Overall, it's very hard to give a strong lead here. There's a lot to play out in this particular race. Jesse G, currently a losing result at $7.50. And even old Paddy Burke, number 1, Saddlecloth, 18 trading off a peak of 29. So there's a little bit to play out here. Just keep an eye on those prices as we progress towards the afternoon, Emily.
Thanks, Stephen. Let's get to the speed map for this next, which is race 3. And Bevan, what did you make of the top end of this market?
Well, I think the speed map's right here. Helena of Troy, Royal Ruby, Choice Attitude, all on speed runners. So they should put good speed into this particular race. Now, Victor Vegas was a horse that Peter Locke spoke to me about through the Hawke's Bay Carnival. Of course, as Stephen mentioned, now transferred to his stable from the Murray Baker team and Andrew Forsman. He was very impressed with this horse and really expected to run a race this afternoon. I'm going to go with a horse I've got a lot of time for. It is Jesse G. Now, I know last preparation may be just that little bit disappointing. You will remember she was a winner on a premier day through the Wellington Cup Carnival, and then the form just tapered off. But I thought that was a very encouraging return to the races for her when running fourth and hitting the line nicely behind Siroc in what was a leader-dominated race. So I think I'm just going to spec a little bit of value for you here at $7.50. Ruby Love, that was a very strong performance at Tarapa behind Polzeath, who has ability. So it goes in for second. She does have a winning record here at Awapuni. Victor Vegas, it might just blow them completely off the racetrack. The troll certainly suggested the horse as well forward for this. Look, Father Lenihan ran a nice race to win last time, beating home 1 prize, 1 goal, who's a horse that I've got a little bit of respect for. So 6, 8, 5, and 4 in a pretty competitive race number 3.
And on to the fourth we go. It is a 1200 metre rating 65 from Awapuni. Up with the market, and Satin Belt is the favourite. Satin Belt fresh finished third. Stephen, what has the money been like for Satin Belt since opening?
Yeah, look, there's enough there. Personally, I think punters were wanting a little bit more than $2.90, but we're pretty happy at 2.9. We're pretty confident in the chances of Satin Belt here in HQ. On the back of a very good first up run and definite improvement second up here over the 1,200 metres. Early speaking against her, last chance, last start winner at Awapuni, has been well supported. $6 you see there in the fourth line of betting off a peak of $9.50. A little bit of speaking around Magico at $8. And back to the second favourite, Electra, hasn't been quite at all at a $5 price. So all in all, Satin Belt heads multis, looks set to start a warm favourite in what is an open race if you want to trade outside her.
So for the fourth on the card, here is a replay of Satin Belt. Bevan finishing in third, got the good second up form, and surely should have improved off of this.
Well, she was half-cooked this day, to be honest with you, and the horse that wins the Tiakia horses put a couple together. So she really loomed up. She clearly blows out. She had a little bit of a sweat on this day. She'd had a couple of trials. She's got a bit of quality about her. Now, she will have to back this up. It was quite a big performance fresh up with a lot of improvement in her. So the back up into her second up performance is a little bit of a concern, but I was willing to go with her as my bet of the day to $2.75. I'm surprised she's drifted out to $2.90. I think she'll probably close in late on in the afternoon. She does have a little bit of quality about here in this particular field. I was willing to give Beltem a little bit of respect in this particular race for Alan Sherrick. His team flew yesterday. I think he produced 3 winners in Monkey Shoulder, who Stephen and the team there shorted him from 31, I think, to 21 in the derby after his performance for fourth yesterday. So Bell Team, it doesn't hold a fresh up record, but it's a horse that's always had a lot of ability. So that's him for second. Miss Contessa, a good second last time, seems to be coming to hand nicely. And outside of that, I put in the 9 Magica, who's a horse with a fair bit of ability. I do have a blowout in this race, and I know it's let us down a fair few times, but Exhibit, if it can find the front, third up, blinkers on, $40, it does have the ability to win this type of race, but you're just taking it on spec at that big quote. But it wouldn't take you a lot of investment to make a fair bit of money. But I thought this is a difficult race outside of Satin Belt, so I'll circle here as my best on the program.
Thanks, Bevan. Let's get you on to the fifth. That is the 2100 metre rating 65. Looking at the market, Starry Bill is the favourite, 291, 33, 51, 90. It is the best backed in this race, Stephen. What else is creating any interest, if there is anything else?
There's three runners outside the favourite that have been specced, Emily. First, Prince Turbo, $7.50 off a higher $10 last start winner. Punters believe it can progress towards rating 65 victory. Red Rascal has been honest as the day's long, $9 off a higher $12.50. Probably do scoop A, you won't see a better galloper and looks-wise throughout the card. Number 14, 23, I see it's $11 on the totaliser, currently a losing result, number 14. But back to the favourite, Starry Bill. Just crunching a few multis numbers, 250 multis in progress, Starry Bill. The next best is Atlanta Peach, 40, so really shows a dominance in terms of betting action around Starry Bills. Had the two runs at a mile, now stepping over Staying Trip, which is the key around this individual. And we'll start a pronounced favourite at $2.90. And we've already just taken, as I mentioned, a $1,000 bet at that $2.90 price. So they're starting to warm up on the Stephen Marsh Train Galloper.
Thanks, Stephen. So Starry Bill there, as we heard, Bevan has been well backed. And I just love the form lines that this horse brings in. I think it's got a very good chance.
Yeah, it's all about the form lines, Emily, isn't it? When you see names like Rhinestone Cowboy, Thomas Aquinas, Lankawi, they're very good form lines. Fresh up at Hastings, Brave, close up behind Thomas Aquinas at Tarapa. And this is a very good run to run 4.5 lengths behind Rhinestone Cowboy, who is an emerging star. So there's a lot of reasons why Stephen has a lot of multis running through this particular horse at HQ. So I can understand that, and I can understand support around this horse, Atlanta Peach. Now, it was shown to us at Woodville, and Guy mentioned to me he thought it had ability. Well, he stepped it up quickly to the 1,600 metres, and he just gave them the go-by. Now, second in this race out wide is Wasaki, who travelled three wide the trip at New Plymouth yesterday and still managed to find a kick and win. So the form has stacked up nicely in this particular race for Atlanta Peach as well. Starry Bill clearly on top for me, emerging into the race is clearly Atlanta Peach. But for second look, I'm going to have a little look at Johnny Lincoln. He's fourth up this preparation. Last start at Hastings, he made a good ground behind Miss Labassa, who's a smart horse who goes to the Trentham Stakes on Friday out of Otaki. At Waipukurau, you can put a line through that run because it was a day where they could not run on, and he got well back, and he was only beaten 5 lengths. He's a real staying type of horse. He's up to the 2,100 metres today. I think he's great value for you, the 9. Atlanta Peach in for third, and then my old friend, Red Rascal. A few of those horses around the CD that have deserved the win have picked them up over the last couple of weeks. Well, this fellow really deserves one. He's been unlucky occasion on occasion. He has 3 kilos off. I hope he can win because he deserves one this preparation. 4, 9, 7, and 5 in race number 5.
Noted down, Bevan. Thank you. Let's get along to the feature. It is the Bulls Country Cup over the 1,500. And Beefeater is at the top of the market. Lisa Allpress to do the riding. Very well backed, Stephen, in this feature. Do we give anything else a chance, or are we thinking that Beefeater is going to be a walkover?
Oh, I do like one in this race, Emily. But firstly, on the betting action, Chance to Dance has been very well supported on Thursday and Friday. A number of four-figure bets for Chance to Dance, who resumes for the Tiakau team, Jamie Richards at Mudder Mudder. It's won two occasions while first up, $5.50 off high as $6.50. I think it's found its mark, though, at $5.50. I would be very surprised if it started under $5, Chance to Dance. On the warm support on Beefeater at $2.20. Now, that is its opening line, and it looks set to start a warm favourite. It already holds 3 times more money than Chance to Dance. And a Maltese, probably one of the highest Maltese progressed gallopers going around on the program at Aupuni. And the one I just want to keep safe for me, Emily, is The Rock. 51 on its back with Billy Pinn doing the riding. Looks to be the obvious leader. The only pace influence outside Ciroc is Scandalo, but outside that, it might get away with a few cheap sectionals. So punters, keep punting Beefeater and Chance to Dance, and I'll have Ciroc in HQ.
Thanks, Stephen. Bevan, we'll get to you. What do you make of this race? It maybe is a little bit more complicated than the market indicates.
Well, I thought Beef Eater was a speed influence in the race as well, to be honest with you, Emily. He led up to this day at Awapuni, sort of set on speed behind Ocean Emperor prior to that. So I think he can be close enough to Ciroc. Look, he has to get a win on board because he does run second and third on multiple occasions, but he does have very, very good ability. This has been beaten by Winspield over the 1550, so the formal Frank Cup, I think Winspield to the Captain Cook. So I've got a lot of respect around him. He's a lovely, lovely animal. I do agree with Stephen that Ciroc, if he gets a very easy sit, he's a big, powerful horse that we saw here last time, and he can kick home strong. I just think Beef Eater may just have that little bit more quality. I spoke to Lee last time around Ciroc, and he just spoke about this horse feeling his joints at times. So he's getting on to another reasonably firm track condition here this afternoon. So I'll go with Beef Eater over Ciroc, but I think they'll 1-2. Outside of that, his chance to dance, I'm not quite so convinced, but you've got to have real respect out of that stable when a money flow does come. And look, Ringo, he's back to the 1550. I thought he was superb over the 2100 metres last time, so back to the 1550. He's a nice miler, and I think he's going as well as he really ever has at the present time. So 2-8-1 and 3-2-1. The 2 and the 8 really stand out here in race number 6.
Awesome. Thanks, Bevan. Let's get you along to the penultimate, which will be the 7th. It is over the 1550, a maiden. Fearless, 290, 135, 470 and 230, Leah Hemi to ride. Stephen, what's the market telling us in the 7th?
Punter's pretty happy to play against Fearless, who almost a default favourite at $2.90. I wouldn't say it's growing with real ability in terms of up-and-comers in this particular race, but there is a couple that they have specced. Original Gangster, who's been well-supported just in the last 30 minutes, Emily, $6.50 off a high of $7.80. Now shares that second line of betting with Stunning, who resumes. 1550 might be short of her best, but the money is on first up for Stunning on her home track at $6.50. A Perrazzo, who did open at a double-figure quote, is now in single figures at $8.50. And War Hero, right at this stage, is a losing result at $10. So there's four or five, just to mention, that have been specced against this favourite. So if you do like Fearless, there is a strong opportunity, from what I'm seeing, that price might drift throughout the afternoon.
Thanks, Stephen. Interesting comments there, and Bevan, no doubt you heard them as well. Fearless, of course, is at the top of the market, but perhaps on the drift. How did you assess this penultimate on the card?
Well, I think the thing with Fearless is that he has a history of feeling his joints and his knees especially. I see the hoof pads go on his front feet. So that maybe just suggests they're a little bit worried about the firmer track conditions with him. He is a lovely horse, and he has furnished nicely this preparation. I think he's been very honest, whereas maybe last preparation a couple of times he wasn't. So I've got respect about him, but I agree with Stephen, his price will drift because people will just worry about these track conditions unless a little bit of rain does come. Now, Original Gangster's the one I'm going to go for. I can understand the money flow here. The horse is very good fresh up and just didn't quite replicate that second up. If you give it one, third up, blinkers on, at home, Lisa Allpress, Royden Burgesson, very much in play for me. I was quite impressed with the Hokio Blanco for Mark Goodwin. Sam O'Malley rides this 4 kilos off. It had its debut at Hastings. It was at a big price. It didn't run like that price. It was only beaten 4 lengths behind Rose Bowl, who's come out and backed that up with another very dominant win yesterday at Taranaki. I'll throw him Fearless. I hope he can win. He's another horse in that sort of Red Rascal vein of form. And outside of that, yes, Stunning. I'm not sure about Stunning fresh up this afternoon, but I'm interested around the money flow for it. 6-4-1 and 11, race number 7.
Thanks, Bevan. Let's have a look at Awapuni Race 8, the last of the day, 384 Wafer. Stephen, what do you make of this last on the card? Is it all about Wafer, or we've got a number of others there in single figures too?
Best bet runner is number 9, Wafer. You see there, $3.80 favourite, and what is an open race? Lisa Allpress does the riding here, so she does profile as a good betting proposition come the last. A little bit of specking around Platinum Wildcard at $6 off a peak of $6.50. Grante Ridge is out of turn, $6 out to $7.50. Adonis, 11 into 9 from a nice each way quote, but overall Wafer, best bet run at a $3.80 price tag, and punter's pretty happy at that shopping right now.
What about for you, Bevan? Are you pretty happy with the Wafer as your top pick, or are you looking elsewhere in the last?
I've only got the slight concern that I don't see a lot of obvious speed in this race, and she is notoriously a horse that is slow away and takes a lot of winding up. So Lisa will have to be on her game to get her into the race. She does have very good qualities we saw in Black Type early on in her career. So therefore, I'm going to go with one excuse me, that actually fits the pounce of yesterday, Edwardian Lady. Always had a lot of time for this particular horse, Gail Templeton, Leah Hemi. Outside of that, I've got a lot of time for Wafer, so 8 and 9. I thought Platinum Wildcard ran a nice enough race, fresh up to go race second up, and then the 4, He's a Freak, is in my selections as well. As far as the spin goes on the program here this afternoon, let's have a quick look at how I'm going to play the program this afternoon. Best bet race 4, Satin Belt. Strategy, it's going to be a 25 poker 3. Total Express and Maria Dior Cornella, Satin Belt to win, Beefeater to win. And if we get a couple of those up, Emily, we'll get a result. We have to get 2 of the 3. If we get all 3, it will certainly play quite nicely into our hands. But like Satin Belt, like Beefeater, Total Express, Maria Dior, we're not playing too far outside the square here this afternoon at Awapuni.
Thanks, Bevan. Great to get your thoughts on that 8-race card from Awapuni. Thank you to Stephen. Thank you to Bevan for your insight into this afternoon's action. Of course, Aidan and Brendan Popwell at Pukekohe as well. Valachi Downs are sponsors of the Punters Lounge Live. They've got the one runner, Terra Sancta. Best of luck to them in the County's Cup Race 7. That's Tony Pike doing the training for Valachi Downs. That wraps up the Punters Lounge Live. We're off to a quick break, and then we get into live action from Pukekohe Park on this Saturday morning. It's like I just came in. I was made for this.